As he took Pender below stairs, the brothers, tailed by Wentworth, made their way into the drawing-room. The scene before them seemed staged, with Arthur bewigged, his pallid, fine-boned complexion rigidly composed, dressed in an outfit of pale cream silk. He stood in an elegant pose by the flickering fire, one hand resting on the mantel. Their sister sat on a chaise longue, her dress carefully arranged to billow around her feet. But the picture dissolved immediately. Harry barely had time to register that Anne had gained some weight before she was out of her chair in a flash, hugging them both and dancing round in delight, unconcerned by her husband's stern look of disapproval. "Arthur," said Harry, finally detaching himself. Lord Drumdryan took his hand off the mantel and, placing it gently on his chest, gave a small bow, leg forward in the prescribed Versailles manner. His linen handkerchief swung elegantly over the front of his coat. For a moment Harry was left staring at the powdered wig on the top of his head. Then he raised himself again to reveal the very slightest of smiles, which smacked of good manners rather than pleasure. A touch of red peeped through the powder on his face. Harry didn't doubt he was pleased to see him, for within the bounds of Arthur's reserve they esteemed each other. But displays of emotion were, in Lord Drumdryan's French-trained mind, bad manners. Yet for all that there was a hint in his look of rigidity that was greater than normal.
"It is truly good to have you safely home, Harry."
The smile disappeared to be replaced by a frown, for James had swung Anne into the air, sending her skirts flying. She caught his eye in her travels and quickly stopped her brother, comporting herself properly with a blush. The frown stayed on his face as he bowed again, and the single word, "James," had little warmth.